Okay, so what do we do? We want to estimate the mean with a confidence interval, but we don't know the standard deviation. In other words, we don't know sigma. Because in reality, it's extremely rare that if we ever really actually know what the value of sigma is without already having the value of mu. And remember, we're trying to estimate mu. So if we already have mu, then why are we trying to estimate it? Now remember, sigma squared equals the sum I equals 1 to the population size n of all the individual values x i's minus mu squared over n. So you see, to have sigma, I have to have mu. But I'm trying to estimate mu. That's what I'm doing to begin with. So this is kind of a circular argument. So if we don't know sigma, which is typically the case, our best point estimate for sigma is then s, the sample standard deviation. Now, this confidence interval, we would think would then have the form x bar plus or minus z of alpha over 2. I don't know sigma, so I will use s over the square root of n. Again, remember under the right conditions, x bar is distributed normal with a mean of mu, a variance is sigma squared over n. I don't have sigma, so I'm simply s or substituting in s, my best estimate for sigma. But this is actually not true. Thanks to beer and a guy named Gossett, who worked for the Guinness Brewery back in, I don't know what year, a long time ago, obviously England, during roughly that time period, we know that the standard normal distribution Z is not appropriate when estimating the mean with small sample sizes. The distribution would be that of a T distribution, not a Z. The small sample sizes, when we're dealing with S rather than sigma, does not actually follow a Z. It follows a T distribution. And this is very commonly referred to as the student T distribution. It's not because it has anything to do with students. Back then, Gossett wrote under this fake name of student because the brewery wanted to keep all of his discoveries proprietary, and he wanted to share it with the rest of the world. So he used a fake name so he could write up these papers and present to the rest of the world the stuff that he found. Just nobody at that time knew who it was. So here's some properties of the student t distribution. It's bell-shaped. It looks like a normal distribution. If I were to draw a normal distribution and a t distribution right over it, you would not know the difference. The t distribution is actually a family of curves, and each curve being defined by what's known as the degrees of freedom. The degrees of freedom are actually simply n minus 1, and we've seen that before. Remember the sample variance? We said s squared equals the sum I equals 1 to n of the x i's minus x bar squared divided by n minus 1. This denominator, n minus 1, is actually dividing by the degrees of freedom. Now, as the sample size increases, the student t distribution, I'm going to draw an error here and say that means converges to a z. It becomes a z. Remember a moment ago I said if I drew a z and a t on top of each other, you couldn't tell the difference? Let's just say for a moment that this is a standard normal. This is a z. This is a normal 0, 1. Now, small sample size t distribution would look something like this. The tails would be heavier. See, the probabilities in the tails change. But as n gets bigger, as n increases, this curve, let me pick another color, starts to look more like this. And as n gets bigger and bigger and bigger, suddenly the t distribution converges to the z distribution. You really can't tell the difference between them. Now, some textbooks will say if the central limit theorem applies, if you have n of at least 30, then go ahead, just use a z, don't bother with a t. Others say, well, you need more than that. I've seen some say as high as 96 for some magical reason. I've heard some people say at least 100. Per stance, hogwash. If you're dealing with sample data, you do not have sigma, just always use the T distribution. Don't even use a Z, because what's going to happen is the difference in probabilities as n gets bigger will get so close to a Z, it won't make a difference which one you used. So why bother with some artificial rule that says at a certain n, I'm going to change distributions? No, just stick with the T distribution. It's going to be the way to go all the time. So where are we now? Our confidence interval for the mean, when the population standard deviation is unknown, will then have the form x bar plus or minus t, and this t has the same alpha over 2, does the exact same thing as z did, but of course we need the proper degrees of freedom. So we need alpha and degrees of freedom to specify t, then s over the square root of n. Provided the appropriate assumptions can be reasonably satisfied. So what are the assumptions for using the student t-distribution? First of all, the data was sampled from a normally distributed population. Okay, we need the population that we came from to be normal. The best way to actually make this determination is to look at a normal plot. And the idea here, if the sample is reasonably normal, and the sample is representative of the population, then the population must also be reasonably normal. So this idea here would apply to small sample sizes. Meaning less than 30. Because at 30, if the sample size is large enough, approximately 30 again, then the center limit is going to appear, and we really don't need to be that concerned about normal plots. Recall the CLT tells us if it's reasonable soon that x bar is distributed normal, and it really tells us nothing about the data. Yet up here, I said that the population that we had to sample from must actually be normal. So then why is it that the CLT will satisfy the assumption to use a t-distribution for small samples? Well, it's really pretty simple. The idea is if the population is normal, then x bar will also be distributed normal. And that's kind of the key here. So the population is not normal, then the CLT will tell us that x bar is approximately normal for large enough n. That's basically why we can use one or the other. If you have a small sample size, you need to take a look at a normal plot and make sure that you're okay. So let's take a look at the normal plot for the speed of light data, both with and without the negative values. So on the graph, you see a normal plot. And then there is the speed of light data. And this is without the negative numbers. This is, I've deleted the negative numbers. And what we're looking for is roughly everything tight and along this line. And this is obviously has a lot of repeated values. There's a lot of repeated stuff in here. So this would be, you could argue that this is reasonably normal, but you could also argue it may not be because the way this is so stacked up. But the idea is I want stuff pretty tight here. The stuff on the end, you see there's a couple of values that kind of stick out here. This would concern me a little bit, but overall this is probably not that bad. Now this is that same normal plot when I put those negative values in. Look what's going on down here. I mean, holy cow. I mean, it just threw everything crazy. If you'd have done a normal plot of this to begin with, you would have said, wow, what is up with this? It's clearly there are two values that are so different from everybody else. That would have alerted you that something is not right. This is the epitome of gross violations of a normal plot. So just what is it that we're looking for in a normal plot? Let's go ahead and draw a couple here. In general, if you have a normal plot, I'm just going to draw the reference line. If you have a normal plot that the data points pretty much hug the line, then we're thinking that that's very reasonably normal. And keep in mind, we only need it to be reasonably normal. What we're looking for are gross violations. If that's my reference line and I have something like this, this is a huge problem right here. This would be not normal. And what we're looking for are gross violations. Sample data will always have violations. The perfect normal plot, which really doesn't exist, I'll change color so you can see it. The data would be just perfectly on this line. I just never have ever seen sample data that ever looked perfectly normal. Stuff like this is reasonable. Or this is reasonable. This would be reasonable if it weren't for this piece right here. So let's go ahead and construct a 95% confidence interval for mu based on the t distribution. And we will do the entire confidence interval in TC stats. Now, when I build this confidence interval, I'm going to do it having eliminated those negative values. So this was the negative 440, the negative 20 is down below, they're gone. So I will select one sample, and this is a T distribution, so I will select T. And then, just as before, this is for the next chapter. So we're going to ignore this piece, but I need to put the confidence level in, that's 0.95. And I'm going to select speed of light and tell it to use the variable. So in other words, I don't have to fill in all this. If I didn't have data, if all I have was a sample mean, sample standard deviation, sample size, I could put those values in and still get the same confidence interval. But I actually have data, so this is saying use the data and find these things from the data. So if I tap update, see here I get the sample standard deviation, sample size, a sample mean. It fills it in so I know what those values are. And here's my 95% confidence interval. So what we are saying is that we're 95% certain that the true speed of light is somewhere from 264.8020 thousand kilometers per second to 290.1980 thousand kilometers per second. So keep in mind that this is based on the data. Now, if you do a quick Google search, you'll find that the speed of light is 299.792-ish thousand kilometers per second. So the confidence interval actually missed. We were 95% certain based on the data that the true speed of light is going to be somewhere in here, but we really missed. It's actually not a big deal in that if you think about this, this is data from the 1800s. You know, if you think about the instruments that he was using back then compared to now, this is a really good estimate to begin with.